The Kissing Booth 3 is the third film of the Netflix original film trilogy. The film stars Joey King, Joel Courtney, Jacob Elordi, Taylor Zakhar Perez, Mace Richardson Sellers, Megan Young, and Molly Ringwald. And this film, again, light spoilers on the first two films in this franchise. Elle, played by Joey King, has to make a pretty big decision in this film. Does she want to go to college with her best friend, Joel Courtney's character, Lee, to UC Berkeley? Or does she want to go to college with her boyfriend, Jacob Elordi's character, to Harvard? That is the big decision Elle has to make in the movie. The film is an hour and 53 minutes and is PG-13. My name is Matt Schirmer. Welcome to a brand new movie review here on Max Talk Movies. We're talking The Kissing Booth 3. Before we start this review, guys, please subscribe and ring the bell if you're new to the channel. I do these types of movie reviews, TV show reviews, streaming platform reviews, movie rankings, and a box office breakdown show. So please consider subscribing and ring the bell for notifications. Also, please comment down below. Tell me your thoughts on not just The Kissing Booth 3, but also the entire franchise. How would you rank the franchise? Tell me, are you enjoying the franchise? Are you done with this franchise? And tell me, what are your thoughts on The Kissing Booth 3 in non-spoiler fashion? Also, please like the video. Let's talk about The Kissing Booth 3. So I am a part of the big detractors of this franchise. I really do not like this franchise. Very passionately do not like this franchise whatsoever. The first two films are really bad in my opinion, and are the worst two films in my opinion of those years. The first one came out in 2018, and the second one came out last year, 2020. And we learned right after that, I think the same day two came out, that they did shoot two and three back to back. So we knew three was going to come out this year. So let's talk about this movie. So as I said, Elle has to make a decision of who she wants to choose, Noah or Lee, to go to college with, or does she want to really just make her own life decisions? And these type of things happen in this movie. Let's start with my only positive with the film. And that is that they really are doing a good effort to try to do a message with Elle's character, that she's been kind of doing everything for other people and she kind of needs to do stuff on her own. That actual story point is what this whole franchise should have been really about. But there were so many other things going on, but that they really try to make a great point of that, especially in the last 20 minutes of the movie, which are easily the best part of the entire, I'm not even gonna say that because I'm not a huge fan of these endings, but I do think that Elle's character does go through something that I think a lot of people do go through, is that they try to please other people, go to these colleges for other people, and she kind of needs to do her own thing. And that's kind of what I liked about Elle in this movie only. And that's my only positive I want to say about this movie. I, once again, do not like this movie, just like I really, really hate the other two. This is a really bad movie with some poor performances, some really awful writing, and characters that are so selfish in this movie that you just can't find yourself rooting for anyone in this movie, including those people who you think are good people, and then they turn out to be jerks too in the movie. It doesn't work out. Now, yes, the cast, if this film more than the first two, feels like a vacation film where they got all these actors back together to do another Kissing Booth movie, because there's so many montages of them doing skydiving and cliff jumping and all these different types of things. Because the whole, one of the main stories of the movie is that Joey King is about to possibly leave Lee and go to Harvard with Noah, but they want to have the best summer, you know, ever. So they do this big bucket list that they created when they were like 6 years old, and they want to knock all that bucket list out to have the best summer. You would think that that bucket list would actually contribute to actual emotion in the story. It does absolutely nothing but show montages of Joey King and Joel Courtney going out, doing some things that a lot of people can't do. And it just felt a very privileged movie. Everything happens in very rich places. The main, most of the movie takes place in this very fancy beach house that for some reason the Flynns let the four of them, the Molly Ringwald and her husband, let the four kids have the house for the whole summer, and they get to do skydiving, they get to do, you know, snorkeling, all of these different types of things. And it just, the movie itself what the movie should have been trying to do is it really needs to be relatable, because again, it's a YA film, and most YA films that really work are relatable. People can relate to some of the problems the kids were going through, because especially for my demographic, I'm literally the prime audience for this movie. I'm literally going off to college very soon, and this should be the exact things, the stuff that I'm going through. Maybe not all of it, obviously, but I should see some resemblances of what I'm going through and what these characters go through in the movie. And that's what makes a special movie to me. But this movie has so many unrelatable things that happen with these kids going to college, and so many selfish decisions are made throughout the entire movie. You really do question maybe every single character decision, because it's so selfish that you can't root for anyone in the movie. And yes, while the cast seems like they're having a fun time together, and that's great, the actual plot of this movie is not good. They bring back so many subplots. That was my biggest issue. One of my issues with Kissing Booth 2, I had a lot with Kissing Booth 2. One was its length, but two was they did way too many subplots going on. They had the Marcos kid, they had Chloe come in, and there was a dance thing. There were so many things going on, and they bring everything back to this movie. Marco is back in this movie. He works at a swimming pool area, I think. He's like a lifeguard, and that brings more drama to the situation. Chloe is back in this movie, which also brings more drama to the situation. But also, you bring all these subplots back from the second movie, but they're also trying to wrap up a trilogy at the same time. And the first, and you wouldn't know that if you watched the first 45 minutes of this movie, which is just montages of our characters having a blast on vacation. And it just isn't fun to watch. It really isn't fun to watch people that you're not rooting for do these fun things. And it really isn't fun. And they felt like there was no story going on for the first 45 minutes of this movie. And then the movie becomes dead serious for the last hour of this movie. I couldn't believe the tonal shit this movie had. It went, and guess what? Half the time this movie feels like a cartoon, but the way these characters act, like a cartoon show, it is quite ridiculous how these characters act. Jacob Elordi is my favorite actor in the entire movie. My favorite aspect of Euphoria, really happy for him. He's clearly mailing it in this performance, which I don't blame him at all. He's fairly fine in the movie. It's just another throwaway performance for him. And you can kind of feel the awkwardness starting to brew with the off-screen drama becoming on-screen drama with the Joey King and Jacob Elordi relationship. You can tell they kind of cut a lot of their scenes down because of the awkwardness of their real life breakup. And you can kind of feel that they didn't want to have the two of them on screen too much in the movie. And Jacob Elordi's character, Noah, feels like such on the back burner to the Lee and L relationship, which it should have been equal. And that's what the whole story was trying to tell you, is that these are equal relationships for her, but they really put Noah on the back burner for a lot of this movie. There's a lot of dumb sequences. There's a Mario Kart sequence that is really bad. There's a flash mob sequence that I couldn't believe was allowed in the movie. The people around these people, like the extras who are reacting to everything going on, it's so unrealistic. And I just didn't care. And the movie also has like four endings. It wants to end like four or five times in this movie. You feel like the movie is ending and it keeps going. And then there's a time jump and you're like, Jesus Christ, why can't we just end the movie already? And the movie is still under 2 hours. When the first 45 minutes of the movie is just throwaway, having fun, I guess. They're having fun. I'm not watching the movie. And then you have four different endings, basically. There just isn't a clear story in the script. I'm not going to blame the actors, because these actors have clearly shown outside of this franchise, they are really good actors. And you can clearly tell that it's the script, it's the characters, the way they are written, and just that you're not rooting for anyone in this movie. And sometimes when you're just watching these people have fun on vacation, that could be fun if you're watching entertaining actors and entertaining characters, but you're not watching any of that. So watching these privileged people go on these vacations, it's just as a whole, guys, this is a franchise I really don't like. Obviously, people are going to compare this to All the Boys franchise, another rom-com franchise that has a trilogy. To All the Boys is light years ahead of the Kissing Booth franchise. I think the first one was kind of average for me, the first To All the Boys, and then I had a good time with the second one, and I really did enjoy the third one this year. I gave it a 3.5 out of 5, the third To All the Boys movie, because that main relationship that they absolutely nailed between Lara Jean's character, Lana Condor and Noah Centineo really worked for me. And there was a lot of emotion with those two characters and the other characters, like the other subplots with Lara Jean's father and that all worked for me. And this movie, they try to do the same thing of Joey King with her dad, where she, of course, is a new mom in the occasion. People overreact and blow things out of proportions to such an extreme level. You can't root or feel sorry for these people. It's just a huge disappointing franchise for me, because they have actors who can really do well in this genre. And for me, it just has just never worked at all. So I'm going to give The Kissing Booth 3 a 0.5 out of 5 stars. I'm going to give it a 15%. That's the best I can give, 15%, because they were actually trying to do a message. If I have to rank the films, I would probably go 3-1-2 if I had to guess, but I really hate them all equally, honestly. It's a franchise I have never liked. They're all my worst films of the year of that year. We'll see if The Kissing Booth 3 by the end of the year remains to be the worst film of the year, but I really do not like this franchise. I really do not like these characters. I'm kind of happy, hopefully, this franchise is done so I have to stop reviewing these movies. So thanks for joining me on my review of The Kissing Booth 3. Please subscribe, ring the bell, like the video. More videos coming down the line. Free Guy and Bad Batch review coming tomorrow. Also, if you're new to the channel, I've already done my review last year of The Kissing Booth 2. I'll leave a video for that. You want to check out all my other movie reviews from this year, click that playlist right up top.